Hello everyone, I'm Anil. I welcome you in my CIB revision class in 30 days. So I welcome you once again on behalf of E.Dot Academy, and we have arrived at Unit 30 of Module D of our book ABM. So starting with credit delivery. Before the credit delivery, a customer always approaches to the bank for loan or credit facility, and we always ask some sort of documents. We take application, we take some forms also, we take Aadhaar card, we take PAN card, we take some credit information, we take some documents for hypothecation, pledge, lien assignment, whatever is there, whatever is applicable for that purpose. So we'll see what are the documents are required and what things we have to keep in mind for preserving, signing, signature. So we'll see one by one. So first and foremost thing is that documents should be properly stamped. It should be properly dated. That means date should be on which the signature has been put by the customer or the document has been executed, that date should be mentioned. And we should also make sure the person who is signing, he has got the complete authority to sign. Either the customer directly are signing or somebody on behalf of the customer is signing, he should have proper authority. And that execution of paper must be of his free will. That means he should not be under any pressure or compulsion that he is signing the papers. For example, if partner is signing on behalf of firm, then he should sign in free will and he should be not signing in individual capacity. He should sign on behalf of the partnership firm. Okay. And next, moving, in case of company, the charge should be registered with ROC. And charge should be registered with the ROC. This we have to keep in mind. And that to be within 30 days from the date of execution of the document. If it is required, you have to register with the CERSAI. So that if any legal complications is there in the recovery of the loan, so we can go for this, take help of the CERSAI, and we can take help of the legal authorities. And if third party guarantee is there, that we should also take in order to make our loan more secured, if it is required. And if it is required, that document should also be registered with the sub-registrar, and it should be done within the prescribed period. So these are the, we have to keep in mind that documentation is very, very important point of view. And if any legal complication is arising, the document will save the bank and it will help the bank to recover the loan. And we have to create the charge also. Charge, mortgage is there, hypothecation is there, pledge is there, lien is there, assignment is there. So appropriate charge must be created. Now next, how the loan should be disbursed, disbursement of loan in case of working capital. So here are the some guidelines are here we should follow. In case of borrowers enjoying working capital limit rupees 10 crore and above, rupees 10 crore and above. In that case, the loan component should normally be 80%. A little bit here, in case of borrower is enjoying credit facility of 10 crore and above, the loan component must be 80% above. But there is some relaxation also. It freedom has been given to the bank that that depends. We can change the composition of working capital by increasing the cash credit component beyond 20%. Okay, that means cash credit component can be increased beyond 20%, or to increase the loan component beyond the 80%. So that means 80 and 20. So 80 and 20 has been relaxed. Normal condition is that we have to make 80 and 20, but in some certain conditions, this relaxation can be granted. But this must be approved by their, it must be in the policy of the bank. That means it must be approved by their board of directors. So I'll repeat it because this very part is very, very important. I'll repeat this case because if any borrower is enjoying working capital credit limit of rupees 10 crore and above, in that case, the loan component should be normally 80%. And loan component 80%, credit component will be, cash credit component will be 20%. So this can be changed at discretion of the bank. That means relaxation has been given with the approval of the board of directors. But in case of borrower enjoying working capital credit limit less than 10 crore, banks may persuade them to go for loan system by offering an incentive in form of lower rate of interest. That means if working capital credit limit is less than 10 crore, then bank will go for loan system only. There will not be any cash credit system. Okay. But in case of certain business activity where the cyclic or seasonal nature is there, then borrower will face difficulties. In that case, bank may have their approved policy from their board of directors, because application of strict application of loan system may create difficulties for these type of borrowers. So depending upon the business activity of seasonal nature or cyclical nature, the bank can formulate their own policy so that borrowers are not facing difficulty. Now next, consortium and syndication of loan system. Consortium and syndication is that when two or more than two banks come together and finance one borrower, is called consortium or syndication. That means when two or more two banks get into formal arrangement of credit facility, in that case is called consortium and syndication. But there is slight difference between these two words. This slight difference between these two words I just explained here. So syndication is the process in which banks come together in short term arrangement, means short term loan, where the syndication is the process in which bank come together where the loan is got granted for the long term basis. Okay, so in these two, out of these two or more than two banks, one bank will be leading the bank, and normally he'll be leading and he'll be collecting the papers, he'll be liaising with the work, common terms, he'll be interacting with the customer for joint documentation, and he'll be deciding the drawing power allotment for the customer. Now next, you are moving ahead with the credit control and monitoring system. Nowadays this term is used for the recovery of the loan, so that, and in between also when credit facility is granted, so in between we have to see the how the credit is going on. So credit control and monitoring often refers as loan review. It is referred as loan review mechanism, LRM, plays an important role in the following aspects. So what are the aspects we'll see here? To ensure that funds provided by bank are put to the intended use and continue to be used properly. Because sometimes what happens, the customers are taking loan for one purpose, but they are using for the other purpose. So this should not happen. There should be continuous follow-up of that. That means for what purpose loan has been taken, same purpose it should be used, and it should continue to be used that purpose only. Number 2 points come to ascertain that business continues to run on the projected lines. Whatever the projected line, whatever business activity was proposed in front of the creditor, or you can say bank, that business activity should be continuous. It's not like the business was all manufacturing of the cloth, but they start manufacturing the paper. Number 2. Number 3. If the deterioration of business continues despite appropriate action, banks should decide if any harsh action. That means if business activity are not taking place properly or business is not growing up, it is going down, then harsh action like recalling the advance and seizing the security, etc., if necessary, can be taken. And one more point is here, the credit monitoring ensure that end use is very, very important. End use of the fund, what for what purpose the fund has been, that should be end use. Performance and warning signals and action to be taken with the available tools for monitoring, credit monitoring, that is called LRM. So LRM stands for, you already seen, loan review mechanism. So we have to see how to monitor that whatever the credit has been given. So here are the some tools we have to discuss one by one. Conduct of account with the bank. That means whatever account has been opened with the bank, maybe current account or saving account or any loan account may be there. We have to see what is the conduct of the account. Means whether account in account the in time installment is coming or transactions are carried out. Sale is coming, discount is going or coming up, that we have to take into account. And one more, we have to ensure that all transactions of the borrower should be carried out by that bank account only. They should not open the other, account with the other bank, and they should transfer all activities there. So we have to see the conduct of account in our bank. Next, we have to see the periodic information submitted as per terms of the advances, because we ask the periodic information like stock available, stock sales. We sometimes ask also the credit purchase data, credit sales data, that we have to keep into mind. Okay, next come audit of stock and receivable conducted by this, very informative, because audit of the stock, whatever stock is available and what is the receivable conducted, receivable are available with the bank, whether the audit of the stock is periodically sent by the borrower or not, and receivables are coming to the bank or not. Next, most important is the financial statement of business and auditor report. Financial statement, we already stated that it's called your balance sheet is there, your profit and loss account there is there, and fund flow statements there, and along with the auditor's reports. So they tell the financial health of the enterprises. And after that, periodic inspection by the officer of the bank to the on-site. So we can also visit the enterprise, how the enterprise is going on, whether they are conducting activity or not, or it has been shut down before that. Okay, and interaction with the local people, we can interact with the local people also, and interaction with the owner of the also, and we have to carry out the periodic scrutiny also. We have to carry out the periodic scrutiny of the documents of the company, and we can take the market report about the borrower and the business segment, because whatever the business is being carried out, they must be selling that item in the market. So we can take the market report also whether the items are being sold or not. And if required, we can appoint a bank nominee in the company board, so that the activity of the company board is also coming to the notice of the bank. Okay, and next is the credit audit. So we have to carry out the credit also if required. So these were the tools of the, we have seen is very exhaustive nature. So these are the credit monitoring tools are here. So we have to see, these tools are very exhaustive. So some may be applicable or some may not be applicable, but these are very list is there. So depending upon the enterprises, we can use one or more or all the tools for the credit monitoring of that enterprises. Now, earlier I decided that I will take only two chapters, but still time is permitting, so I will cover the unit 32 also, that is risk management and credit rating. So, credit risk monitoring can be done by mitigating the three types of main credit risk are here. These are called operational risk, market risk, and credit risk. So, operational risk is nothing but it may arise due to fraud, disruption of business activity due to the natural calamity. It may also happen to the system failure also. Like nowadays, we are working in the computer system. So, our computer system also may be corrupt or some may be shut down also. And sometimes may happen our generator is not working and power has so power supply is not there. So, this is also called operational risk. And coming to the next, market risk. Adverse market movement of interest rate. That means our business activities are also having the risk of interest rate that is totally controlled by domestic market as well as international market. And credit risk, inability or unwilling, that means unwillingness of the customer or inability of the customer to pay back the our loan. So, this become the three factors, three credit risk are there. We can remember like this in form of CMO. Chief Medical Officer, no, is there one post is there. So, C stand for credit, M stand for market, and O stand for operation. Now, there are some external factors which affect our risk, and these are the some factors are there which affect our risk. These are external factors are there and internal factors are there. So, external factors, that means exchange, interest rate, change, government policies and political risk. So, these are the external factors which affect our risk. Means risk may arise due to the these type of factors. And internal factor like means our bank policies, overexposure to sector. If we are exposing our credit facility to one particular sector and that particular sector has gone down due to some reason or other reason, then it will affect. These are called internal factor. Low quality appraiser, because our appraiser is not good, we are just closing our eyes and we are distributing the credit facility. So, it may affect our credit monitoring system. Okay. And proper monitoring is not there. That means after giving the loan, we have to properly monitoring how the this activity is going on. And then lastly, lack of efficient recovery mechanism. Nowadays, because NPA is engaging, so all banks are giving stress to the recovery. And they are developing their innovative idea how recovery to be made. And many banks are coming to their robust idea of mechanism of recovery of the system. So basically, we are discussing about the what are the risk factors are there. But in banking business, because we have to give the loans to the customer. So when we give loans to the customer, the risk involvement is there. And we cannot reduce risk to zero, so but we can mitigate the risk. So next we'll see how the risk may arise. Means risk may arise due to micro level also and macro and micro. Macro is the big level and micro is the small level. That means when we are doing something in the branch level, that becomes the micro level. Okay. And micro level is the big one. Like our HO is making some policy, our journal office is making some policy, or our circle office is making some policy, that becomes the macro level. So, what the micro level is going on, that we see here. So, macro level means our credit system has a bigger threat, because branch can control only one type of customer, but our journal office, they are controlling the biggest size of customer. So, risk to overall credit portfolio of the bank are mitigated through frequent reviews on norms and fixing internal limit. Internal limit for aggregate commitment to a specific sector of industry or business. That means we can fix a limit to particular industry. That means now we are talking about the bigger sense. Particular industry or business and exposure is evenly spread out in the various sector. So, there will be likely less loss. If one sector is going down, then other sector will remain intact, the loss can be mitigated. And micro level, if you talk about the, this pertains to the policies of the bank regarding very small level. Means I'll say branch level, like your pressure standard, your sanctioning and delivery process, your monitoring, your review of individual proposal, categorization of proposal, obtention of collateral security, credit rating, credit score, and also play important role. That means we observe very minutely at the small level. So macro and micro means when we talk about the micro, that means we talk about the bigger level, and we talk about the micro, we talk about the small level. And credit rating also play a very important role in giving a loan to the customer, because based on the credit levels nowadays, this trend has started that if credit rating is low, then we charge more interest rate so that our risk factor is compensated. That means person having good rating, like if we talk about the CIBIL 700 and more, we always try to attract that customer because their rating is good. And we also give some sort of concession that will charge with less interest for that. Where the credit rating low is there, like 600 as per CIBIL is there, so we charge more interest rate. And what is credit default? So credit default is nothing but inability or unwillingness. That means either customer is not able to pay or he is unwilling to pay. Sometimes he is not willing to pay, like some fraud has happened in case of PNB. So we have seen that these customers are not willing to pay back the loan to the bank. And now NPAs, we talk about the NPAs. So substandard is there, doubtful is there, and loss is there. Substandard means the account has become substandard, doubtful, and loss. And I will discuss later on in the next classes also. The next in the paper of next. Okay. Now willful defaulter, that means what are the cases which are considered as a willful defaulter? Defaulter, even though borrower has capacity to pay, that means customer has ability but is not paying. Diversion of the fund or siphoning of the fund, that means he has diverted the fund to some other project. He has asked for the fund for the one project, but he has diverted to the some other. Or siphoning of the fund, like he has taken the loan as for the working capital, but he has purchased the asset. So this is called siphoning of the fund. Disposal of the security, that means security has been collateral, but he has disposed of security and he is condemned to cash without the knowledge of the bank. This is also called the willful default. And what are the options available for the stressed asset? So this is the last resort that banks should adopt. Number one, the exit. And exit means banks should hand over this loan to the some other banking system or financial company. Rescheduling and restructure. Nowadays, this is being used because sometimes what happens, the customer is not able to pay some reason or other, some calamity is there, like in this way, because Corona was there. So many loans account has been restructured. That means again, their time period has been extended. Restructuring means time period has been extended. Okay. And rehabilitation, sometimes what happens? Enterprise is not able to pay the loan. That means we ask them, the manager staff, and we give further extend credit facility so that that enterprise is restored. That is called rehabilitation. And sometimes we go for the compromise also. Compromise also, like some customer has taken 5 lakh rupees of loan, and if his present liability has come up as 10 lakh rupees over the period of some time. So we come to the compromise, or we'll say, you pay the principal and you exit from here. And last action is there, the legal action. Legal action. And we go for the legal action also. We go to the court, we go to DRT, we go to the company board also, what was there. And we go for the, if nothing is there, we go for the write-up also with the approval of the board of directors. So these are the ways available for the handling of the default of the loan. Now next is the credit information system. In past, what was happening? The one customer was taking loan from one bank and is not taking, uh, not paying, and then other going for the other bank or other financial issue, they were taking loan from the other bank also. So there was not communication between two types of bank. So this, because data was not available, data was not transferred from one bank to another. So there, this was felt that credit information should be shared with all others. So there was need for, there has to be one central agency which can restore the data and share with the bank or financial institution. So need of credit information system was felt in order to alert the bank and FIRs. So requirement of an adequate, comprehensive, and reliable information system on the borrower with efficient data was felt by the RBI. So for this purpose, RBI established Credit Information Company. So first company that was established and the recommendation of working group headed by NS Siddiqui. So one working group was set up, and then Credit Information Bureau India, a name was CIBIL, CIBIL was set up in January 2001. So first credit information company that was set up is called CIBIL. This was in association with, set up by SBI in association with HDFC, and later is was renamed as TransUnion CIBIL. Nowadays we are using as a TransUnion CIBIL Limited. But in addition to this, other three companies have also been permitted as CIC, and the name of these companies are, you can see here, all four companies you can remember that. So nowadays CICs are four companies are here: CIBIL, Equifax, Experian, and CRIF High Marks. And their score is also reconciled. Nowadays, earlier their scores were different, they were using the different scale for that. Nowadays they are having the maximum score as 900. Earlier their score were varying. Okay, now how they work. So here you can see CIBIL collect and maintain record of all individual payments pertaining to loans and credit cards. That means data is passed to the CIBIL by the bank in periodic basis. These records are submitted to the CIBIL by bank and other lenders on monthly basis or sometimes some agreed period of time. This information is then used to create the credit information report. So we have been generating this report in case of the borrower is approaching the bank to take the loan. So we generate the CIR is nothing but it is credit information report. Sometimes we call it CIBIL report also. Now next is the CRILIC. Very important topic for this point of examination point of view. Center Repository of Information on Large Credits. So RBI has set up a CRILIC. CRILIC is nothing but Central Repository of Information on Large Credits. What CRILIC does, it collect, store, and disseminate credit data to lenders. Okay, but limit is there. This data is given only if exposure is 500 crore and above. 500 crore. In case of CIBIL, there was no restriction. There was no restriction, but banks are required to report to credit information, including classification of account, SMA, in all their borrow, having aggregate fund based, non-fund based, means fund and non-fund based, both are included here. Exposure is 500 crore in above. Okay, so banks are required to report to credit information, including classification of account. Okay, that means if account is classified as SMA, then this report is given to the CRILIC, and exposure should be 5 crore and above. But one exemption is there: agri loan is exempted. Exposure to NABARD, SIDBI, Exim Bank, and NHB is also exempted. That means agri loan is exempted, but other agri loan are not exempted. Okay, so there is difference between CRILIC and CIBIL. CIBIL take all the loan activities, where the CRILIC take only the activity which is 500 crore and above. And In addition to that, banks also required to report outstanding current account balance of their customer, whether debit or credit, because current account may have debit balance or credit balance 1 crore and above. Means banks is also required to report to CRILC if their customers are having either credit or debit balance in their current account. What is the value? 1 crore and above. Ceiling is here. 5 crore normal, and in case of current account, 5 crore is in case of the loan and 1 crore in the case of current account. So, for this, the banks are required to report to CRILC. So, I think we have covered everything. I have made every effort to explain everything in a very short duration. I am sorry if something is left or something is missed because it is a revision class. So, something might have missed or something might have overlooked due to our speedy revision. So, stay tuned with me for the next video. Very soon, I will be uploading the, I think, last chapter is left for this module D, and we'll finish very soon. After this, we'll start our BFM class. Okay. So, stay tuned with me. Thank you very much. Good day.